Hi guys, and welcome to the latest episode of Indie Fix. I'm Adam from eGamer, and today we're going to be talking about Phil Fish and his comments about YouTube and revenue sharing, and really what the argument is and the debate is surrounding that. It's a very interesting point. It's been a big week for Phil Fish once again in the news. So I hope you guys enjoy the show. Cue the theme music. Firstly, I'd just like to point out that much of this video has been taken from articles on eGamer, which you can find, one written by our very own Alessandro about Phil Fish initially wanting Let's Players to pay for using footage from the games that they use in their Let's Plays. And there's also a very interesting video about the implications of fame and the concept of fame as connected to Phil Fish, which you can also read about if you want to know more about him and the whole fiasco surrounding him and his Twitter meltdown and all that kind of stuff. And also, I looked at two articles, one from Forbes, which was written by Eric Kane, a very good article called Phil Fish's Run About YouTube and Revenue Sharing, and a very excellent article from Gama Sutra, written by Mike Rose, entitled Is YouTube Killing the Traditional Games Press? And these all offer a really broad perspective, so if you're interested in finding out more about the Let's Play scene and its impact on the success of indie games, it gives a really good broad view, especially the Gama Sutra article. Let's get the show on the road. So let's first set the scene involving Phil Fish. So we haven't heard a lot from Phil Fish in the recent months because he cancelled Phase 2. And as this article by Alessandro says, Phil Fish hasn't been the most talkative person lately. He had the social media meltdown, which I mentioned previously. He cancelled Phase 2, and he's considered a very controversial indie developer. This week, he responded to news about PewDiePie, the world's biggest YouTube personality and Let's Player, who's earning $4 million a year from just playing games. Fish, in response to this, obviously wanted to voice his opinion, stated that YouTube content creators should be forced to pay the developers of the games they play. There was a series of tweets, after which he deleted his account, and in those tweets he attacked YouTube content creators for making a living off developers' games, and he compared it to piracy. Here are some of the tweets. YouTubers should have to pay out a huge portion of their revenue to the developers from which they steal all their content. Ad revenue should be shared with developers. This should be built into YouTube. Anything else is piracy. He went on to say, if you generate money from putting my content on your channel, you owe me money. Simple as that. He went on again, if you buy a movie, are you then allowed to stream the entirety of it publicly for people to watch for free? No, because that's illegal. He also said, systems are in place to prevent that, but buy Fez, put all of it on YouTube, turn on ads, make money from it, and that's totally fine. And the developer should in no way be compensated for their work being freely distributed to the world. Right. Makes sense. And Alessandro actually points out here that what Phil Fish is not able to do is that YouTube has put in systems in place for monitoring this content, and this has affected the Let's Play community very much so, because a developer can say, well, I'm not getting any revenue or monetary benefit, and they can pull their content and say, put a copyright claim down, which is what's happened with a lot of videos, especially when Let's Players like Total Biscuit, for instance, was given games bad press. They get copyright claims slammed on them. There's also the whole debate about Let's Plays generating millions of revenue for games due to free publicity, generating a lot of sales. And Alessandro doesn't exactly elaborate on it, but he brings it up. And this Forbes article here that I've linked below in the description really sort of brings that more to the fore. it's again reiterates what Alessandro article basically said, and but it also brings up a lot of the quotes from the Gama Sutra article and contextualize them. And here's some of them talking about, he says, yeah, full fish is an odd position among developers, and especially indie developers. He says in the Gama Sutra article, they speak with a number of indie developers about the impact of Let's Play videos on sales and publicity. And here's straight from the horse's mouth, essentially, from devs themselves. So here's a lovely quote from Aaron's son, Filippo, the creator of Race the Sun. For sure, the biggest YouTubers have had a much bigger impact on our traffic and sales compared to the bigger sites we've been covered on. And there's Cliff Harris of Positech Games, who said, I'm not really aware of any game site for whom coverage of your game results in an immediately noticeable sales spike, but I've seen with a YouTube Let's Play, and it basically says there that there's a big impact. And YouTubers have a very different relationship to the viewer than the games press, for example. And sometimes it can be very adversarial between YouTube content creators and developers. But when it's friendly, there can be a symbiosis. And Let's Play videos can be really good tools for getting exposure out there, and can boost the sales of games. Really, there is a fundamental misunderstanding of the relationship that leads for Fish to make these claims. Basically, he makes a lot of assumptions, and he thinks that game developers should expect revenue sharing from the YouTuber when what they really get is free advertising for their games. There is no guarantee that the game will generate excessive views, but if there's a lot of hype behind the game, the indie game, it can. But that also just leads to more sales for the developer. But it's really put here well by this article from Forbes. He, Phil Fish, equates posted an entire movie on YouTube with a Let's Play video, but these are two very different things. In the Let's Plays, in the Let's Play, viewers are able to see whether or not they want to purchase the game. They also come for the personality of the person playing it and their reaction, either because that person is entertaining or informative or valuable in some other way. He says here, this creates value for both the developer and the consumer, as well as the middleman. Revenue sharing at this point would be very much like asking someone to pay you for advertising, and that's really what Let's Players do. They're advertising games for indie developers when it's even a popular one. And everyone thinks that all these Let's Players are hectically popular. Not every Let's Player is going to be popular, but you do want to get your game sent to some of these Let's Players, because the popular ones will get your game noticed. And he says, yeah, Phil Fish and other developers are getting free exposure. It's free. There's no monetary value associated with. So YouTube personalities have to make their money elsewhere, and advertising is one of them. And of course, YouTubers are using footage of games to meet their own bottom line, but they're not pirating or selling copies of a game. They're encouraging the increase in sales. And it's not posting a movie to YouTube in any kind of way. If you look at the one side of the coin, you have like a company like Nintendo, who announced a revenue sharing platform for Let's Play videos. And this is a huge mistake, because Nintendo should actually be making money off game sales, not game footage and commentary. And that is where it's problematic, because he's basically, Phil Fish wants to be Nintendo, it seems. Or wants devs to be like Nintendo. And that is not the way to go. And really, I think I agree with the Forbes article. There's a misunderstanding of the nature of new media, which that's what the internet is. And YouTube is very much new media. And it's a culture of sharing, hacking, and altering content, which can lead to content going viral. And you want your game to go viral. If you pester in a YouTuber for payments, do you think they really want to put your game up onto YouTube and show footage of it? And really, this makes potential customers not want to play your game because it leaves a bad taste in their mouths. You want to encourage people to buy your game and increase your sales. And that's really that fine line. And if you look at the Gama Sutra article, for instance, you see a lot of confirmation of that YouTube coverage is essential. For sure, the biggest YouTubers have had a much bigger impact on our traffic sales compared to the biggest sites we've been covered, as I said, with the guy from Race the Sun said, Aaron Sanfilippo. He elaborated on this. When Dan Nerdcube played Race the Sun and linked our Greenline page, it had a bigger impact than all of the website coverage we had up to that point. I'm pretty sure that Total Biscuits coverage on our Steam launch day helped increase our week one sales a lot, which probably helped us on the Steam front page, helped us to keep us on the Steam front page longer. If we're smart, we'll try to arrange this type of event more intentionally next time. So it really is beneficial. You could even look at Borut Pfeiffer of the who made Skulls of the Shogun from Studio 17-Bit, who agrees with it. He says, most indie game success stories on PC in the last year or two have had predominant YouTube coverage. With their game Skulls, they sort people out and send out hundreds of review codes to YouTubers, which is a lot more time consuming than regular press, but because the YouTubers don't have consistent contact info, but the impact can be astounding. But what needs to be stressed is that YouTube is not the platform for every type of game, and there's this assumption that all indie games work on YouTube. There's a UK dev called Dan Pierce who found that YouTube influence has varied effects on the sales of a specific game. He had a game called Castles in the Sky, which had various sales spikes and very few additional sales, even with a YouTuber who had 120,000 subscribers, he only had 13 additional units, so it depends on the type of game. He then had a... because initially his game, Castles in the Sky, was just a 10-minute long game, and it wasn't suited to the Let's Play audience. However, he found that his quick reaction game, 10 Second Ninja, told a different story, and here he says, as far as I've seen, we haven't had significant spike from written press, but we have seen spikes from YouTube, he says. So specifically, getting covered by Total Biscuits gave us a sales spike that roughly mirrored the game being on sale for a week. Getting covered by Dan Nerdcube brought in a bump of about half that, despite his video having roughly 100k more views. So it does vary, it depends on the audiences and the reach. But you can see that there's a very positive benefit from being on YouTube, and if one consistently enforced revenue sharing on these Let's Players, developers wouldn't be able to get the exposure and really free press that YouTubers offer and the vast audience they can interact with. And that's really what it comes down to. And really, at the end of the day, Phil Fish is just incorrect in assuming what he does. And that brings this episode of Indie Fix to a close. I hope you enjoyed the show. Give us a like if you enjoyed the video. Subscribe to our channel if you like our content. I hope to see you guys next week. Leave a comment in the comment section below. Have a good one, guys.